continue with the analysis of the open systems, but here there are three important figures that show the importance of thermodynamics applications in different places. And the two are from the book by Shapiro. So these are the thermodynamics book. And then there is one more thermodynamic application. And you can see that all of them, here we have the control volume here. These are the boundaries of the control volume. And for the heart, so you can see the control volume boundaries. And for the turtle here, you can also select your control volume. Okay. So the leg of the turtle is missed. You can add it. Little funny stuff. So you can add the control volume boundary here for the turtle too. So in all of these cases, you can apply the conservation of energy and find the required properties of the systems. And this is the application of the, you can say that here we have that bioconnections. In the simple words, we can say the bioconnection of thermodynamic. And here you can see the tree, and you have some solar radiation on the tree in the some amount of, let's say that it is 100%. Okay, this 100% of sun energy is lost as the evapotranspiration. Okay, it is the sweating. Very similar to our body, the trees also sweating. How do they sweating? They take the water from the ground, okay, and then transport the water to the leaves and the body, and then sweating this water with 7 to 8%, and this is the loss. Okay. It is not used as the useful energy. And then the trees are losing 21% as the heat, and then some of the energy is reflected, and only 1% of the energy is used for the useful purposes, which is the biomass production. In other words, it is the wood and the plaster leaves. Okay. Only 1%, but the rest is used for the different purposes, like to keep the tree cold, that is by the sweating, and it can be used as the heat transfer by the winds, okay, if there is air around it moving, and it will take the heat transfer with itself. And similarly, there can be done the control volume analysis on heart, and by doing that control volume analysis, you can find the arrhythmic movement, so arrhythmic movement of the heart, because that in some, so this is abnormal problem with the hearts, because that in some, the hearts of some people can be arrhythmic, and it can change its periodicity for some time, and for some time it can be periodic, and it can beat fastly for some time, or it can be slowly. So it is not that constant and steady, but it changes with time. Okay, this is arrhythmic behavior. Okay, rhythm change with respect to time. And this one can be analyzed also by selecting control volume and analyzing the inputs and the outputs to the heart. Or the similar energy transfer analysis can be done on the turtle here. You can see that sun energy comes over it, and some of them is lost as radiation, some of them as evaporation, and some of them as the wind. As the wind moves over it, you can have these convection losses, and also the conduction, because here it is in contact with the solid material. These are just three important applications of the thermodynamics for biological animals. Okay, so now comes continuing our last example from the previous lecture. In the last lecture, we are solving this example, and we are trying to find what is the, that is velocity at the exit and the heat transfer per kilogram of air. Okay, we have found the velocity at exit, we have solved it. Now comes the heat transfer per kilogram of air. Now we can find it. So for that one, I will write the first law of thermodynamics. And the first law of thermodynamics says that you will have into the mass, let me write it as, that this one is the steady. Steady and the CV is open system. Therefore, that in should be the same as out. Okay. And since this one asks for per unit kilogram of mass, so I will write this one as, so that enthalpy in plus, the velocity here is not considered, because that you can also consider, let's consider it, you will see that it is very small. Velocity integrated by 2, and the potential energy change is negligible, therefore not so important, and you will have that the enthalpy out and the velocity out squared by 2. This is for the enthalpies. And then you will have that heat transfer into the system, which is that Qin. But you should keep in mind that for any open system, okay, let me write it here, but you should always remember it for any open system, so that enthalpy is there. You can write, you have to write the enthalpy in equation balance, energy balance. But for most of the thermodynamic systems, if you remember, we have talked about this one, that kinetic energy change and the potential energy change are small for most that thermodynamic systems. The kinetic energy change is similar to potential energy change and is zero. It's not so important. The only important variable is enthalpy for most of the thermodynamic systems. But for problem, the velocity, for this problem, velocity is given. Therefore, I consider it, but you should remember that the velocity is not so important for most of the thermodynamic devices. Now let's solve it. It says that you have the, let me see. Okay, the velocity at inlet is 5 meters per second. And the velocity at outlet is found in the last lecture, which is 6.66 meters per second. Okay. And the enthalpy at inlet and the enthalpy at outlet, they are unknown. Okay, now we are going to find these enthalpy values by using the table. Okay, and let's use the table and to find the enthalpy values. Okay, the, we have the table and we have to use the table for air. Table for air is H17 and for H17, and if you are assuming that air is ideal gas, and then for ideal gas behavior of the air, here you have that the temperature is at 25 degrees at inlet. Let me go back to the chart here. 25 degrees means that 298 Kelvin. Since we are interested in the enthalpy value, which will be 298.18. So this one from A17. On A17 at 25 degrees Celsius is 298.18 kilojoules per kilogram. Now you can notice that the units are not consistent. This one is in kilojoules, but this one is in joules. So therefore, I should multiply with 10 to the power of 3, and it makes that 1 kilojoule, it makes this amount of the joules. For the enthalpy at outlet, again, I have to use the temperature value, which is 90 degrees, and 90 degrees will be that, you will have that 90 plus 273, and it will make that 363 Kelvin. I go back to the chart here, the table here, so that we have the 260, is 260.58, 270, and 270.7. So let me write it here. Okay, so that it is 300, sorry. For 360, the enthalpy value is 360.58. And then for 370, it is 370.67. This is the enthalpy value. And now we have to find the enthalpy for the temperature, which is 363. And to find it, firstly, this one is the enthalpy and this one is the temperature. We have to use the linear interpolation. Okay. And if I use the linear interpolation here for this one, so that you will have that enthalpy change minus 360.58 and divided by, that is the slope of it, which is okay. And that this one should be equal to the enthalpy that we are interested in, minus the enthalpy value, divided by the temperature that we are knowing it, minus 360. Okay, this is the linear interpolation. Now you can calculate that linear interpolation value and then write a true value, please. So this one is 360 You will have here 360.58. Here you have that 370, and here you will have that 370.67. In between, I am assuming that it is linear change, and it is somewhere very close to 363. I'm trying to find this x value. And I'm assuming that the values are very close to each other, so that linear approximation is valid. Okay, and if you calculate it, the value I think should get very close to 363. Okay. Now let's see the correct value, 363.61 Ali Sayer. Okay, so this is the enthalpy value for the outlet. So for this one, enthalpy value is 363.61, again kilojoules per kilogram, and multiplied with 10 to the power of 3. Okay. If you do this calculation, if you do that calculation and calculate the value of the Q in, you can see that how the kinetic energy changes, how kinetic energy change is small with respect to change of enthalpy values. But this one is 6.66 squared by 2, but this one is 363 times 10 to the power of 3. Even if you consider the change in enthalpy versus change in kinetic energy, you can see that the value is very, very small. Okay, we can compare the values for both. Okay, so compare the delta kinetic energy versus delta enthalpy. Delta kinetic energy will be equal to 6.66 squared by 2 minus 5 squared by 2. This is the kinetic energy change. Now let's look at the enthalpy change. Enthalpy change is 363.61 times 10 to the power of 3 minus is 298.18 times 10 to the power of 3. And if you calculate these two values, you will get that. Let me do that, and you will have a year 3, and you will have 4, and 5, and you will have 6. 65.43 times 10 to the power of 3. And this one is 65430. Joules per kilogram. This is for the enthalpy change. But if you consider the change in kinetic energy, and this one will be much smaller than the change in enthalpy, and let me calculate it. And that value will be 19.4 divided by 2. Okay. And this one will be equal to 9.678, okay, joules per kilogram. And if they compare the magnitude of this one, delta kinetic energy versus delta potential, delta enthalpy versus delta kinetic energy, you will have that equal to, so that 676.1. Okay, this one is 6,000, approximately 7,000, greater than the value of the kinetic energy. So you can see, if you take that kinetic energy change, is approximately small, is zero, doesn't affect too much. Okay. You can see, because it is very, very small. But for if it is nozzle, and if it is diffuser. So here we mostly consider kinetic energy change. Okay. But for any other systems, we don't consider. Why do we consider for the nozzle and the diffuser? The reason is that nozzle is used to, it is used to increase kinetic energy. This one is used to decrease kinetic energy. Therefore, we have to consider the kinetic energy to see how efficient these systems are. Are they converting to kinetic energy efficiently or not? So now let's go back to the Q in value. Has anybody calculated the Q in value here? So that it is 65,539.7 joules per kilogram. It is the kinetic energy that the Q in into the system. Okay, so with this one, we have finished this question. Now comes the next question. Okay, this question is asked, so. But this question is, we have the mass flow rate of 4,000 kilograms per hour that is flows through a turbine with a power output of 800 megawatts. Here you can see this one is a turbine. You can see how large the turbine is. It is used for the steam and it has different components, different compartments actually. They have that high pressure side, you have the low pressure side. But anyway, it is not so important to consider these compartments for thermodynamics one. But this is a turbine. The real turbine looks something like this one. It is so large and the shaft, this shaft is connected to the generator, and then you get the electricity. Okay. And the power output, the electricity that you get from this turbine is 800 megawatts. Let me write the values that are given. Work output is 800 megawatts. And the mass flow rate is, and that is 40,000 kilograms per hour. This is the mass flow rate. And at the inlet, pressure is 50 bars. Pressure at inlet is 50 bars. Okay. And then the temperature at inlet is at 620 degrees Celsius. The pressure drops to 610 kilopascals at the turbine exit. So that pressure at outlet is 10 kilopascals. So what it means is that as the steam comes in contact with these blades here, these are the blades, okay, they are rotating. This one also rotates. These are also all rotating. And as the steam passes through it in that way and in that way, as it passes, the pressure of it drops. Pressure of steam drops. Okay. And it starts with the 50 bars here. And then traveling for these compartments here, the pressure drops to 10 kilopascal. Okay. And then the velocity at inlet is given. Velocity at inlet, the moisture content and the velocity at outlet are also given. So that moisture content at outlet is given and the velocity at outlet is also given. That velocity at inlet is 5 meters per second. Moisture content at outlet is 7%. And then the velocity at outlet is 40 meters per second. These are the values that are given and they determine the heat transfer during the process and show it in on TNE diagram. Because the steam is very hot, as it travels through this turbine, it gives off heat to the environment. Okay? But most of the cases, we consider the turbine as insulated turbine, because the heat loss from the turbine is not desirable stuff. If you are losing heat, it means that heat is energy. Okay, whenever you have the heat loss, it means that you have energy loss, that's all. So for the turbine here, you have the heat loss, it means you have energy loss. If you have the energy loss, then you cannot get higher power output. Okay. This is the main problem with the system here. But they are trying to make the turbine as insulated as possible so that you can have the minimum amount of the heat loss. So I will write this turbine is in a schematic form as something like this one. For this turbine, I have the inlet. So this one is inlet. You have the outlet. This one is outlet. You have the heat loss to the environment, say that Q out. And you have that work. Sorry, I couldn't, let me put that out part here. Q out, mass out, okay. And then this one has a shaft. You can see the shaft here. This is the shaft. this shaft rotates, it gives you electricity. Okay. And then the question gives all of them as watt units, therefore I will put a dot over all these quantities here till the work dot and the Q dot, and the work dot out is 800 megawatts. Okay. This is actually the power that is produced from a thermal power plant of Azerbaijan. Okay. And with this value, let's solve the problem. Okay, now I will write the first law for the turbine. First law and the steady. And if you remember, we have said that always for open systems, we have to have this enthalpy. Therefore, I will just write that mass flow rate into the system. Mass flow rate, it brings with itself enthalpy, it brings with itself kinetic energy, and it brings with itself potential energy at inlet. Okay. And then that one will be equal to mass flow rate at outlet. It takes itself with the enthalpy, it takes with itself kinetic energy, it takes with itself potential energy. Plus, it also gives Q dot out to the environment, it also gives work dot out to the environment. This is the principle that you have got. Now let's write the values that are given. Work dot out is given as 800 megawatts, 800 times 10 to the power of 6 watts. Potential energy in and out are not considered. You can see that it is so small that it's not so important. Even if you look at the real turbine here, this is the inlet potential energy. Sorry, that isn't inlet. Okay, so inlet I cannot show on this figure here, but that if you look at the size of it, if you take the maximum with this one and the outlet with that one, okay, you can see that this height is not so much. Therefore, the potential energy change is small. And then Q dot out, it is not given, it is asked. And we can find the enthalpy values. And let's solve for the enthalpy values at inlet and enthalpy values for the outlet. Okay, let's try to find it. And for the first one, the enthalpy value at inlet, enthalpy at inlet. You can see that the pressure at inlet and the temperature at inlet is given. So pressure at inlet is 50 bars, the 50 bars makes 50 times 10 to the 5 Pascal. It makes 5 megapascals. This is the 50 bars. And the temperature is at 620 degrees Celsius. This is the temperature. Now I should go to the table for these values to find the enthalpy at inlet. This is the first part. For the second part, it says that moisture content at outlet is 7%, and for outlet, okay, the temp pressure also is given. Pressure drops to 10 kilopascal. Pressure at outlet is 10 kilopascal. So that enthalpy at outlet, I will use that. Pressure is 10 kilopascal. But here you can see that there is that moisture content. So who can tell me what moisture content is? Let me see your comments, because we have considered this one in our previous lectures and we have talked about the moisture content. What is moisture content? Can tell me? Okay, no one. Good. But the moisture content is 1 minus quality. This one is 1 minus x quality. So that here x is 93%. Therefore, for the outlet, the quality is given, which is 93%. Now with using the table, I will find this one, and I will find that one, and then find the rest of the problem. Okay, so I will present a screen with you, and that screen will be that table. Now you can have a look at the table here. And for the table values, what I need is that, firstly, I will need 5 megapascal, 620 degrees Celsius. And the first thing I should check is that saturated water. And I'm going to the saturated water table. Where is that? Saturated water. And that 5 megapascal. Okay, let's see that. 5 megapascal, and the saturation temperature is 264. But the temperature that I'm looking for is 620. So the question comes to you that which state is this one? Superheated, saturated, or compressed? The question is at 620, but this one is at given 264. So, of course, superheated, Mehmet Ali, yes, you are right. It is superheated. So the first part, therefore, I should go to the back, superheated table. Okay, superheated table, and for the 5 megapascals, I should take this one, 5 megapascal, and the temperature of, where is that? 620. Therefore, I should just copy this table here. Okay. And I will add it to the slide. This one is the first part. Now comes the second one. Second one is that pressure is 10 kilopascal and the quality is 93%. Therefore, so is this, which state is this one? 93% quality and the 10 kilopascal of pressure. Which state is it, this one? 93% of quality. So is it saturated, superheated, or compressed? 93% of quality and the kilopascal of pressure. It is of course saturated because the quality is only defined for saturated state. Therefore, I should go to the saturated state for 10 kilopascal. And I will just again the copy and the paste this one to the slide and solve the problem now. Now you can see the for the presentation here. So the first one is that I will look for the enthalpy value at inlet, which is at 5 megapascal and the 620. Again, you can see that I have 5 megapascal pressure here and the 600 temperature. And the enthalpy value is, I'm looking for the enthalpy value here, yes, this one. For the second value, which is 700, now let's see the 700 here. And again, I need interpolation. So that by linear interpolation, you will have that. Okay, so what I'm going to do is that 900, it will be that. 0.3 minus 3666.9 divided by the temperature difference, which is 700 minus 600 Kelvin. Unit is not important here. That one should be equal to that. The enthalpy value that I'm looking for, minus 366.9 divided by the temperature difference. So with this linear interpolation, you can tell me the value of the x, and we can find it. And then after finding the value of enthalpy here, you will work out the enthalpy value for the outlet and finish this example. Okay, there you have that. 3,758 kilojoules per kilogram. So let me write it back to the equation here, so that 58. This one is kilojoules, therefore I should multiply with 10 to the power of 3. Now comes the enthalpy for outlet. Enthalpy for outlet, it is function of pressure and the quality. For 10 kilopascal, Now you can see it. This part is the internal energy, no need. And enthalpy part is this one. And if you remember the chart for our TNE diagram, you have the temperature, you have the NEO, you have something like this one, and you have the pressure values here. And for here, I will have this. This part is HF, this part is HG, and the quality here is about 0.93. This is the X. And to find the H value, it will be HF plus X multiplied with HG minus HF. And this one will be that HF plus X times HFG. And in the chart, HF is given, which is 191.81 kilojoules per kilogram. X value is 0.93. And the HFG value is also the difference between them, which is 2392.1 kilojoules per kilogram. And from here, you can find the value of the enthalpy. So if you have it, you can tell me the value of enthalpy for the outlet. So you can see how large the enthalpy values are with respect to kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is a very small value. Even if for this problem, if you do not consider the kinetic energy, you will not have any error. The error, of course, the small error, you will have that, but it will not be so large that it will affect the final result. And the Mehmet Tavi Madat says that 2416.46 kilojoules per kilogram. I will write it back to here. So 204.16.46 kilojoules per kilogram. Therefore, I will multiply with it 10 to the power of 3. So kinetic energy at inlet, the velocity is given as at inlet. So 5 meters per second. You can see it is very small value. For the completeness of the problem, I am writing it. But you have to know that this kinetic energy value is not so important. Just for the completeness of the problem, I will write this one as 5. And for kinetic energy at outlet, 5 squared by 2. For the outlet, the kinetic energy will be that 40 squared by 2. So you can see there will be only one unknown, which is that Q dot out. And you can find that Q dot out by subtracting these quantities here and find it. So Q dot out will be equal to, I don't know, it may come to be negative here. If it is negative, it means that actually there is heat transfer into the system. The value of Q dot out is, it is not required to be positive quantity, because we are assuming that there is heat transfer from the system. But it may be possible that the change of energy from inlet to outlet is such that it is less than for the work dot output, and therefore the system even itself needs Q dot heat transfer to the system to produce that given amount of work. So does anybody calculate that Q dot out? So I forgot to add one thing here, is that mass flow rate. Okay. Mass flow rate here is 40,000 kilograms per hour. So then you should convert this mass flow rate as 40,000. Let me write it in a different place because doesn't allow me to do that. This mass flow rate value will be 40,000 divided by at 36 hundredths. Give it at kilograms per second. This is for the mass flow rate value. Okay. So these are just numbers. You can replace the numbers here and get the final value. Similarly for outlet, you will have the same mass flow rate because it is steady system. And mass flow rate into the system, same as mass flow rate out of the system. Okay, since steady. Okay, the final result is that negative 798.
Calculator üzerinden tamı sefti değil mi? Cevap 798.702.
Okay, so you can write it as a comment.
Ya sadece nöqtə yoxdur. 702'den var.
Okay, so one more time, please. Okay, so you have 7, 9, 8, 7, 0, 2, 3, and then you will have this times 10^3, and this one is negative. Okay. If there is any calculation error, this is the final result. So what does this final result say? That Q dot out is negative. Okay. So it means that there is Q dot in into the system. Okay. So why there is Q dot in into the system? Because that to produce that given amount, the given amount of work is too high. Okay, to produce that high amount of. But to produce that high amount of power output, we all require that we require heat input to the system. That power amount that you expect from the turbine is so large that the given amount of the enthalpy change of the liquid or the steam is not enough. Okay? We will need Q dot in into the system. Okay, so there is one more example for the closed open systems. So we have a pressure and the temperature at inlet of the throttling valve, which is a thermal expansion valve. Okay, so it is 6 bars and 51 degrees Celsius. This is the inlet. Find the enthalpy at outlet. This is the question. So what is the thermal expansion valve? The thermal expansion valve, this one, is used in the refrigerators. Okay, and it is used in air conditioners. So this is the general working principle of the refrigerator or air conditioner systems. I will not talk about it separately, but I will just write the components that you have got. And here you have this compressor. And then you have this here. This part is the condenser. And then you have this part that is important for us, the thermal expansion valve. And then you have the evaporator here, and then back to the compressor here. Okay, so what happens is that the refrigerant here, this one is the, let me write the components there separately, but first show you the path that refrigerant travels in that way, and then comes back here, then here, and it takes a spiral motion here, and then that way, and down here, moves up. Okay. Then the thermal expansion valve here. So I will not talk about these components here and these components here, but these are additional stuff. The main thermodynamic processes happens inside these tubes here. Okay, and then back to the compressor. So this one is pressure measuring device. This one is pressure measuring device, and this one is safety valve. You have the filter system to filter out the contaminants. And then you have this, the thermal expansion valve, and this one is the main switch. Okay. Now let's see the chart in the cycle in a better form. You have this compressor, and then from that compressor, you have the condenser. And then from that condenser, you will have the thermal expansion valve. This one is shown as TXV. Okay. And then from the thermal expansion valve, you have the evaporator, and from that evaporator back to compressor. And here you have, at the inlet of the compressor, you have the saturated. So let's not just write the saturated. So inside the system, you can have different types of the different types of the fluids that work. Okay, so but the general name of the fluids that are working inside this cooling system is called the freon. Okay. But you should remember that the freon is the name of the company. Okay. It is not the name of the refrigerant. Okay, it is like that. You, when I say that Ariel, you understand that it is detergent. But when I say that it is freon, you understand that these are refrigerant. But there are different types of the refrigerants, but the famous one that we are using is that R134a. Okay, this is famous one, but now prohibited. Now it is banned. The reason is that it is ozone depletion. Okay, then you have that R410, and then you have different refrigerants. Okay. There are a list of them. Okay, these are the two famous ones. So compressor inlet, you will have that X1 and refrigerant. This is the name of it. Okay, it's like the water. And then you have the outlet, it is that superheated. Okay. And then you have got the condenser, and the condenser outlet, it will be X0. And then you have the thermal expansion valve. Here you will have that mixture. And at the evaporation part, you will have this evaporation and back to X1. So in the condenser part here, you are giving off heat. So it is that Q out. And in the evaporation part, you are getting on heat, which is Q dot in. And here you are Q dot in. It means that the evaporator part, this part, it cools. And the Q dot out means that it heats. This is the general stuff that happens inside this refrigeration system. And the part that is important is the throttling valve. Okay. So this valve, the name says it, it is the valve. What is the valve? It controls, regulates flow rate. It regulates M dot. It regulates M dot through the system. If it closes M dot, it means that there is less refrigerant into the system. If it opens it, you have the spring system here. If it opens it, you have more refrigerant and more cooling. Okay, add it, less M dot means less Q dot out, which is this one. Sorry, that it should be Q dot in. And the more M dot means that more Q dot in. Okay. More refrigerant means that more cooling, and the less refrigerant means that less cooling. Now we will analyze this thermal expansion valve, what happens. This thermal expansion valve, in simple terms, I will show it just there. So you will have this valve here. This is the valve. You have decreasing area, and then this is the valve. But general configuration is much complex. Okay, I'm just analyzing it in simple form. And this one is the one, okay, here, and this one is the two. And this is my control volume. Similarly here, I'm selecting my control volume. Let me select it with a different color here. But this is the thermal expansion valve, you can see it, but this is the my control volume. This is the control volume, CV. I'm selecting my control volume as this thermal expansion valve, okay? But you should remember that this is not such like this one, okay? This is the simplification, but in reality, you have different components here. You have that spring system, valve, etc. But at the end, it serves the same purpose as this one. Okay? They have the same purpose as this one. Okay, now let's write the energy balance, the first law. Okay. If I write the first law for this one, and the one is here, this is the inlet, and the two is here, this is the outlet. This is one inlet, and this is two is outlet. Okay, if I write the first law, and I will say that it is steady. Okay, if it is steady, and I can write that H1 enthalpy at 1 with mass flow rate M dot plus that V1 squared by 2 and plus that GZ1 will plus. So for this system, I don't know what is the heat transfer in or out. I don't know it, but I assume that it is Q dot in. Q dot net in, this one, should be equal to that M dot and the H2 plus V2 squared by 2 and plus GZ2 and the plus that work dot net out. Okay. You will see that I will cancel out the terms, but this is the general configuration. Okay, so what is the value of the work.net? So you can write me it as a comment. What is the work done by this expansion valve here? What is the work done by this expansion valve? Let me give you some options. A is zero, B is not. I give you two options. So A or B. It's not zero or it is zero. There is no work done by the fleet, okay, for this valve here. Okay, good. And the comes that potential energy. What is the value of the potential energy? Is it zero or not? What is the value of the potential energy? Is it zero or not? It's zero. Of course it is zero. Therefore, this one goes to zero. This one goes to zero. Okay. Now comes the heat transfer. For heat transfer, I will make a review for you, and I will go to my previous slides here. You remember in the previous slide, we have said that heat transfer is proportional to area and needs time, and most of the time we have insulation materials. Now comes back to our problem here. So you can see the condenser one, you can see there are lots of zigzags. Here you have also lots of zigzags. So why do you have lots of zigzags? You can say it. Why there is lots of zigzag? So what it helps for me? So it increases surface area, you are right. Now comes the expansion valve. For the expansion valve here, it has small area. Okay, and therefore small area means that small time, so that not small time, let's say that not enough time. So there is not enough time for cure. Therefore, this term goes away, zero. There is no heat transfer. Actually, in reality, there is heat transfer, but the surface area is such that that heat transfer is not so important. Okay. And I'm going back to, again, a perfect part of my slide, and we have said that there is that. Here, you can see that del H by del kinetic energy, it is very, very large. And except nozzle and diffuser, for most of the systems, we don't consider the kinetic energy because it is small. Okay, and therefore, so that the kinetic energy is approximately zero. So it becomes that H1 same as H2. Okay. The enthalpy across the thermal expansion valve is constant. So here it enters with enthalpy of H1, it leaves the expansion valve with enthalpy of H2. The refrigerant enthalpy enters with H1 and leaves with H2. But H2 and H1, they are the same. And since this is same, and we call this term as isenthalpic device. This one is called isenthalpic device, and enthalpy is, you know, conserved for this device. So therefore, if I know the inlet property, if I know the inlet temperature, I can find the enthalpy at outlet. It is very easy stuff. So that enthalpy at inlet, it will be at 6 bars and 51 degrees Celsius. Okay? And the refrigerant that I'm looking for is R134A. For this refrigerant, I'm looking for the values at inlet, and I'm going to find the enthalpy at outlet. Okay, now let's solve it for the refrigerant here, and I'm sharing the table with you so you can see it. So what I need is that I need the refrigerant R134A. Let's go that one. You can see the refrigerant here. The first thing is that, of course, the saturated region. So check it if it is saturated or not. Now let's check it. So for the pressure of 6 bars, let's look at it. This one is the temperature, and I need the pressure, which is 6 bars, and 6 is bars, that's 600 kilopascal. Okay, this one. And for this one, temperature is 21.55, but in my case, it is 51 degrees Celsius. So Is it saturated, superheated, or compressed? In my case, it is 51. Okay, Ali Isayev, yes, superheated. Mehmet Dağı superheated. Okay, now I'm going to superheated one with the 6 bars. 6 times 10 to the power of 5. It will be 0.6 megapascal. With this one. For this one, I just copy it. This one, I just copy and come back to my slides here. Okay, and I'm going to find the enthalpy value here. Let's find it. Okay, so the table is here. So I need this pressure and the temperature is 51. So I have 50 here and I need enthalpy. I have the 60 here and I need, of course, enthalpy again. So it will be that 299.98 minus 290.28 divided by 60 minus 50. That one will be called x minus 290.28 divided by that 51 minus 50. Okay, from here you can find the value of it. It will be that actually it is very easy stuff. 290.98 plus this one is by 10 and it will be that 0.9. It will be 970. Okay. And this one will be that 291.25 kilojoules per kilogram. This is the enthalpy value for the inlet. Okay. But for the thermal expansion valve, we have determined that enthalpy remains constant, doesn't increase or decrease. It is isenthalpic device. But here what you should remember are approximations. Okay. Approximations is that it has small area, not enough time for heat transfer. There is no work transfer because it is a valve. Okay, valve means that you have the decreasing area and the flow velocity change. That's all. And then you have this potential energy chains are neglected, okay, because if they are at the same horizontal line. And then you have that enthalpy is conserved. Whatever enthalpy at inlet you have, that enthalpy will be the same for outlet. And this is for the thermal expansion valve. Okay, so we have solved this problem. If you have any questions, you can ask. Otherwise, I am moving on the next question here. 7. 7 means that. Okay, so what is 7? The value of it, yes. 7 is this part. No, I think it is 297. Yes, this one is 97. I mean 0.97. Okay, good. This is true. Okay, good. So we have one more example here. So that if I cannot start the example numerical values, but at least I can explain what happens here. We have a water with a moisture content of 18.7% at 10 kilopascal. It leaves the turbine to the condenser and after passing it is transferred by pump at saturated liquid state. So what does it say? You can see this is the turbine here. This part is turbine. Here you have that turbine. And this is the generator. You are getting electricity. And we have said in the previous example, if you remember it, the turbine at outlet, you can see the temperature value at outlet. There is that. It should be somewhere around here. So we haven't found the temperature at outlet. We have only, yes, we have 10 kilopascals. And temperature at outlet is 45 degrees Celsius, 45.81 degrees Celsius. This is the temperature at turbine outlet. What is, so from previous example, this is from previous example. And the outlet temperature of the turbine was at 46 degrees Celsius. Again, it's 46 degrees Celsius. So what we are trying is that for to make it cycle, it should be cooled. So it should be cooled back to initial value. Okay, to cool it, we are using the condenser. Okay, so that this is the general that power plant, and here you have this condenser. This part is the condenser. Okay, what is a condenser like? Let me show you here. Okay, in the condenser part, you have the turbine outlet here. So this is the turbine that is steam out of turbine. Okay. And it goes inside that condenser here. It travels in that manner. I don't know how it looks like, but maybe one solution. Okay. And then it leaves. Okay. And this is the out of the turbine. Okay. And inlet for the condenser. The green one is the condenser. This one is condenser. Then you also have that cooling water. Okay, here you have the cooling water. So it may flow here. This is the out for cooling water. This is the in. In for cooling water. Okay. It flows around the tubes. You can see it flows around the tubes. And inside these tubes, you have inside it, you have that steam. Okay. But around it, you have the cold water. And this is the general configuration for the condenser. And this is the turbine here. The turbine inlet comes into that condenser. You have also the, so you have also the cold water that comes in and the hot water that leaves the system. Okay. So the values that are given in the question says that 8.7% and 10 kilopascal, that is for inlet, is 8.7%. It is the moisture here. And the pressure is 10 kilopascal. And then at outlet here, it is saturated liquid state. So saturated liquid state. This is for outlet. And here you have also that cooling water. It comes with 20 degrees, comes with 20 degrees Celsius, and it leaves with 40 degrees Celsius. This one is 40 degrees Celsius. You can see heat exchanger. This is heat exchanger. It is like that money exchange. So that you give your dollars and you get the manat. Similarly here, you give your hotness and get the coldness. Okay. This one part is cold, other part is hot. One part cools, other part heats. So steam comes with 18.7% and with 10 kilopascal, travels in that manner here and leaves the system. These are the tubes. And the cold water comes with 20 degrees Celsius and it flows around it. Okay. So that it flows around it in that way, in this way, around it. Okay. It is filled with it. It is around it. And then you are having the 40 degrees at outlet. Okay. The question is that what is the heat transfer between these two? Raise this ones here. Okay, and okay. So what is the heat transfer between these two? Okay, so I will stop it here. Now I will continue from this example in our next lecture. So let me stop the recording. If you have questions, you can ask.